Good morning. Welcome to today's edition of Your Social Security. I'm Tonia Heckman, and I'll be joined today by Jackie Taveras. Good morning, Jackie.
Good morning.
We have several topics we'd like to discuss this morning. The first topic is our online services. Now, I know we've gone over this many times in the past, but our website is constantly changing, and Social Security is changing to improve our services to the public. We've done this to be able to keep up with all the different services that we provide to you, and so that you have more options to make your life easier and more convenient. There are many topics and different things that you can look at and do on our website. Please check out our website today at www.socialsecurity.gov. If you do need to visit our office to be able to complete your business with us, also know that the Reading Social Security offices, as well as other Social Security officers, offer self-help computers within the office that you can complete your business yourself. You don't have to wait in long lines, depending on what it is that you've come to the office to do. You can do such things as apply for benefits, such as retirement or Medicare. You can also make changes to your record if you're already receiving benefits, such as an address change, a telephone change, or an update to your direct deposit. And you can also do such things as print your benefit verification letter if you should need so. So there are many things that you can do that you can avoid waiting in line within the office or waiting to talk to someone over the telephone. So visit your local office if you need to, and try one of the self-help computers to help make your life a little bit easier. Now, Jackie, I believe you have some topics that you'd like to discuss.
Yes, good morning. Good morning. Today we're gonna discuss benefits for the elderly, aged claimants that have to be 65 or older. Aged claimants that are coming into the United States of America must have legal status in the U.S. All claimants must have original birth certificates, a valid identification card. Claimants with legal status in the U.S. must see original immigration documents. For aged claimants that need help handling their Social Security affairs, we have our version of power of attorney. Social Security does not acknowledge power of attorney. Our version of power of attorney is the representative payee. It has to be someone with no criminal charges, no family record, must be somebody who's employed. We rather a family member. And this person's responsibility would be to handle all Social Security affairs, whether it be change of address, change of phone number, getting the claimant's benefits and making sure that their rent is paid, their utility bills are paid, that their food is paid for. And then once a year, the representative payee that we choose would have to complete a form. It's called a pay accounting form. This form is very important as being a representative payee. This is where you explain how you spent the claimant's benefits throughout the year. You know, how much you paid, how much you spent of their money in utilities, rent, clothing, personal items, medications. You should keep receipts of everything that you pay, so that way if there's any issue, you have your proof at hand.
Jackie, mm-hmm. Question for you. I understand, I believe, that the representative payee, although the person receiving benefits can suggest who they would like to be their representative payee, I believe it's the office's responsibility to assign and choose who that person would be. Is that right?
Correct. Because the thing is, no one can come in and say, I want to be payee for this person. We have to, there's an interview process that needs to go on. We must also, the representative payee has to be at least 18. Like I said, no criminal record. So not everyone can serve as a representative payee. It doesn't matter if it's you're the daughter or the son of the claimant, or if you're the neighbor. We determine who's going to be the best payee for the claimant. Our job at Social Security is to make sure what's the best for the claimant and their and the well-being of the claimant. If there is no representative payee available, then the agency can, you know, we can pick an agency to represent the claimant as well.
And Jackie, also you had mentioned aged claimants. Could you define what aged means?
Aged means when you are 65 years of age or older. There's two programs at the Social Security office. The primary is Social Security Disability. This is for people that have worked and have 40 quarters and can retire and collect Social Security, or for survivors, retirement, disability. But then there's the secondary program, which is SSI, Social Security Supplemental Income. And this is where, you know, even though you may have not worked, not have worked enough, or children, or also aged, the elderly, 65 years or older, can qualify. But they also have to be interviewed and determined to see if they what they qualify for. With Social Security, what we do is we take, for a retirement claim, we take 35 years of earnings and compute their benefit amount, and that stays the same every single year. With SSI, it's very different. It's a needs-based program. It's a type of federal welfare program where it depends who you're living with, your income, your resources, if you pay rent, if you don't pay rent. So it varies how much you can get, and it could change every single month depending on your income and resources.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Would you like to explain a little more about the program?
Well, the way you can, if you're interested, or if you have an elderly parent maybe coming out of the country, or if one thing I wanted to mention, if anyone coming out of the country, whether they're elderly or not, they must be in the United States 30 days. So you have to have your plane ticket or your passport to prove when you entered the United States. It has to be 30 days. And once you have your 30 days in, you can call us and set up an appointment to get benefits. The numbers are 866-274-5960. That's the local office number. We are open Monday through Friday, 9 to 4 p.m. And on Wednesdays, we close to the public at noon. So Wednesdays is 9 a.m. to noon. The national number, they're open 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. Monday through Friday. And their number is 1-800-772-1213. Again, it's 1-800-772-1213. And they're open 7 a.m. to 7 p.m.
Okay. Do you have more?
Oh, I'm good.
Okay. We're going to get a little bit now into a change that is happening with Medicare cards. For those who are already receiving Medicare benefits, there's the new Medicare card project, which is rolling out right now. It is a joint effort between the Social Security Administration and the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, also known as CMS. And it's to remove Social Security numbers from all Medicare cards. This initiative was introduced with the Medicare Access and Children's Health Insurance Program, also known as CHIP. And the act requires CMS to remove all Social Security numbers from all Medicare cards by April 16th of 2019. As I said, this is a rollout project. So if you don't get your card right now, it will happen sometime between now and April 16th of 2019. And it's in an effort to prevent fraud and identity theft. So the current health insurance claim number, which is known as an HICN, which contains the beneficiary's Social Security number, will be replaced by a new Medicare beneficiary identifier. The MBI consists of 11 characters in length with numbers and uppercase letters. The numbers are randomly generated and are non-intelligent, meaning there's no hidden or special meaning behind the numbers and letters that are assigned. We're going to place up, here is an example of a Medicare card that will be sent out. As you can see on the Medicare card, it shows the new Medicare number where the arrow is pointing. It's a new non-intelligent unique identifier that has 11 bytes or 11 characters, and which is a combination of the numbers and letters, and has key positions 2, 5, 8, and 9 will always be alphabetic. Okay. We're also going to put up an example of a letter that you may receive in the mail. This is once you've received your new Medicare card with your new number and identifier. When you receive a letter, at the very top there where it's boxed in, it has your BNC number, which is your own assigned Medicare number. And also down at the bottom where it has the paragraph, it says your Medicare number is, and it actually spells it out right there. At the top, it's X'd out. Certain numbers and letters are X'd out, but at the bottom will tell you what your number is. And that lets you know, so that way you can know what your identifying information is. So that's something new that's happening here. And as I said, it's a way to prevent fraud and identity theft going forward. So it's a very good thing that we're doing, and you expect to receive your new card in the mail sometime between now and April 16th of 2019. We'll also get into a little bit more in depth about enrolling for Medicare Parts A and B. For those who aren't already receiving Parts A and B, understanding Medicare isn't as difficult as you might think. It's a benefit most working Americans can count on. And here are some facts about the program that we're going to go over. One, some people may ask, can I still get Medicare at 65 years of age? Yes, you're still eligible for Medicare starting at 65, no matter what year that you were born. If you or your spouse worked and paid Medicare taxes at least 10 years, you're eligible for Part A, which is hospitalization, at age 65, and that is free. There's no cost to you for Part A.
And what's the percentage that Medicare covers?
80%. 80%, exactly.
Correct.
So Part A helps pay for inpatient care in a hospital or a skilled nursing facility following a hospital stay. It also pays for some home health care and hospice care. You're also eligible for Part B, which is the medical insurance for physicians, if you choose to get it and pay a monthly premium. Part B helps pay for services from doctors and other healthcare providers. Outpatient care, it also covers for home health care, durable medical equipment, and some preventative services.
I want to interject something about you mentioned that Part A is free, but Part B is not free. And we have a lot of people in Berks County who may be eligible for the state of Pennsylvania to pay their Part B premiums. But the only way you know that is by going to your state office, the Department of Public Welfare, located at 625 Cherry Street, the third floor in Reading. And their phone number is 610-736-4211. And I believe they're open 9 to 5, Monday through Friday. You can go in there and request for it's called State Buy-In Medicare Part B Help. And they can go back up to 3 months. And once they agree to pay your Medicare Part B premiums, Medicare agency will reimburse you 3 months back of what we've taken out of your Social Security. So that's a good thing. And I don't know what their guidelines are, but it doesn't hurt to try and apply for that. It's a really big help.
Absolutely. Especially if you're someone who's receiving supplemental security income already and are applying for Medicare benefits. Absolutely. As we know, it is a needs-based program, and so is supplemental security income. So if you are already receiving that, you may qualify, and it's worth checking into. And even if not, they do have income limits and such for that program, mm-hmm. But theirs are different from ours. So it's worth looking into and seeing if you have very high costs.
And there's three agencies. I know it's very confusing for our elderly, but there is three agencies that you're dealing with. You're dealing with Social Security Administration, which is federal. You're dealing with Department of Public Welfare, which is state. And then you're dealing with Medicare agency, federal mm-hmm. insurance. Mm-hmm. So,
absolutely. If you're already receiving Social Security benefits, you will automatically be enrolled in Medicare Parts A and B at age 65. Because you must pay a premium for Part B, you can choose to turn it down. However, if you don't enroll in Part B when you're first eligible for it and then choose to do so later, you may have to pay a late enrollment penalty as long as you have Part B coverage. If you're not receiving Social Security benefits and you have a 7-month period, which is your initial enrollment period,
which is 3 months before the month of your birthday and also 3 months after, and that's the initial. Mm-hmm. If you miss that, then you have, if your spouse or you're working and you're covered, working full-time and covered with health insurance, you have, that's called the special enrollment period. If whenever you stop working or your spouse stops working or no longer covered with health insurance through the employer, you have 8 months to request enrollment in Part B with no penalty. Okay? And then there's the final one. If you miss the initial, you miss the special enrollment mm-hmm. period, there's the general enrollment period, which you can only apply January, February, or March of each year, and it's not in effect until July 1st.
Thank you, Jackie.
Mm-hmm.
So know that originally you have the 7-month initial enrollment period to sign up for Part B. Generally, your initial enrollment period begins 3 months before your 65th birthday. Mm-hmm. It includes the month that you turn age 65 and ends 3 months after your birth month. So if you're covered now under an employer group health plan, you may have the special enrollment period mm-hmm. for Part B. So if you're 65 or older and covered under a group health plan, either from your own or your spouse's current employer, you may have a special enrollment period during which you can sign up for Part B. This means that you may delay enrolling in Part B without having to wait for the general enrollment period and without paying the lifetime penalty for late enrollment. Additional rules and limitations do apply, so if you think that a special enrollment period may apply to you, you can read our Medicare publication, which is on our website, at www.socialsecurity.gov/pubs. And you can visit the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services at medicare.gov for more information. Now, to avoid a tax penalty, you should stop contributing to your health savings account at least 6 months before you apply for Medicare. If you have an HSA, which is the health savings account, when you sign up for Medicare, you can't contribute to your HSA after your Medicare coverage begins, or you may have to pay a tax penalty. Premium-free Part A coverage begins 6 months before the date you apply for Medicare, but no earlier than the first month that you were eligible for Medicare. To avoid an unwanted penalty, you should stop contributing to your HSA 6 months prior to filing. You can withdraw money from your HSA after you enroll for Medicare to help pay for medical expenses like your deductibles, premiums, coinsurance, or copayments. If you'd like to contributing, though, to your HSA, you shouldn't apply for Medicare or Social Security benefits.
Now, I wanted to interject something before we leave. Not only retirees can apply for Medicare. If you have a disability and you're getting benefits from Social Security Administration because of a disability, you have to have 24 months of a disability beyond benefits, and then your Medicare will also kick in. So it's not just for 65 or older. People with disabilities getting benefits for 24 months will get the 25th month, they will be enrolled automatically in Part A and B.
That's a great point, Jackie.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you may be asking, how much does Part B coverage cost? You're responsible for Part B premiums each month. Most people will pay a standard premium amount, which this year is $134
Correct.
For 2018, if you sign up for Part B when you're first eligible and don't incur a penalty. This amount can change every year, and you could find up-to-date premium amounts on Medicare.gov.
There's also Part C for supplemental coverage for the 20%. It depends how sick and how often you go to the doctors. And we have finally Part D for drugs, prescriptions. To know, you have to be enrolled in Part B to get C. And the way you get C and D, you call Medicare, 1-800-MEDICARE directly, and an agent will be happy to enroll you in that and help you with whatever questions you have.
And before we leave you today, we just want to mention again, please, if you haven't already, check out our website at www.socialsecurity.gov for more information about all the services that are provided to you online.
And also tools. There's a retirement estimator as well.
Exactly. And in addition, make sure that if you do have to come into our office, depending on what your situation is, if you don't have to talk with someone directly, if you're just coming in for a simple change or to print a benefit verification letter or apply for benefits, depending on what they are, such as retirement, Medicare, you can do that at one of our self-help computers that are within the office. As I said previously, there's always someone available to assist you. So you're not on your own. If you have questions, if you're not sure how to fill out something properly, someone's there to help you and guide you along. So always be open to that so you don't have to wait in long lines. Okay?
Yep.
Well, thank you so much, Jackie,
for
your help today. We appreciate that. And
thanks to all that are watching.
Exactly. And this wraps up today's edition of Your Social Security, and we will see you next month.